You could be wiser as an educated advisor. Hello, everyone. I'm Steve Savine, syndicated financial columnist and Money Color commentator. On today's show, Tax-Free Income Under HECM, part three of our series on the HECM retirement strategies with mortgage broker John Mingles, all here on Let's Get Down to Business. Welcome to the third segment, John.
Thanks, Steve.
John, of course, again, I just want to reassert, not only you, present day, you are a broker, a mortgage broker, but you were a certified financial planner for a long time.
Yeah, when I first got in the business, that was...
But doesn't, I mean, everything we're talking about, this is why it's great to talk to you. Most brokers did not come from the financial sector. So we're always having to, hey, here's how we use this and that. Yeah. But you know it. And that's why I have you on here, because you already have the background and the historicity. And it kind of gives you a little bit of a pedigree. Okay. So let's talk about tax-free income. Now, our advisors understand tax-free. Shockingly. I had a client on the other day. They had municipal bond holdings. It was extensive. I noticed on their page two of their 1040, they were paying alternative minimum tax. And I was curious. So I said, hey, send me your entire, if you want to redact the names and so forth, and you don't see it. But I need to see what's going on here and what caused your AMT on the second page, line 36. So he did, and I said, you know, you got money here, municipal, some of it, not all, but some of your municipal bond holdings are causing the alternative minimum tax. And he was like infuriated. And then I said, and all of your municipal bond income, all of it, flows over to the provisional income test for Social Security, and that pushes you to tier two taxation on Social Security, which is an ordinary income tax event,
right?
Which, of course, infuriated him even the more. When we're talking about tax-free from HECM, we're talking about an equity loan. Equity loan is not reportable income.
True.
That's so correct. I don't have any of this AMT.
Correct.
There's not going to be anything stealth tax. I'm going to wake up and say, I bought too much of HECM here.
Right. Yeah, there's fine print.
Now, let's talk about this. Now, at the beginning of the first segment, you mentioned, hey, there's a lot of ways to take income here. So you were talking about taking, I could take it in a lump sum. I could take it for a lifetime. I could take my HECM in time certain. I only need it for 10 years. Maybe I'm getting inheritance. Maybe my qualified plan will be really big at 70. And I'll take it from there. And I can pay it back. I may not want to pay it back. Is that all the flexibility of HECM?
Yeah, for the most part, that's it. And then, of course, there's the appreciating line of credit that we've talked about, mm-hmm. which would just, if you use it, you don't have to use it, and mm-hmm. you just let that available credit grow.
Here's a strategy I want you to think about, because it could make so much sense, and especially it will make money sense. When you're looking at 62, that's the earliest time we can come in and start taking Social Security. At 70, we have the maximum age right now, and for most boomers, that's that eight-year period. You're 62. 66 full retirement age, and then you got your maximum age 70. If you say, Steve, I really need my income now, or I need some kind of income now, and I say, I have no problem with that. I just don't want it to be Social Security. Does it matter to the client if he's taking the government program Social Security versus the government program home equity mortgage program? I say, well, it doesn't matter. It's still coming out of the same pocket, but no tax. Social Security, I have a 25% discount. If I'm still working or have any W-2 or 1099 income, that also gets put in here. But now when you talk about taking an equity line of credit from HECM, that is a loan that's tax-free, and it's not going to at all flow over to the provisional income test for your Social Security benefits to be taxed.
Correct.
Right?
Yep.
So make sure. Okay. Okay. So our strategy is let's go ahead and use HECM income instead of Social Security income. You told me in two segments earlier that most of you have thousands and thousands of mortgagees, your clients. You said that most of them are taking their money at 62.
That is correct, yeah. So we're seeing...
Wow.
Seeing that.
I mean, that to me, I mean, that I told you about that article in the first segment. We really experience 4% of all seniors are waiting till age 70. Only 4%. So I think we're really hurting ourselves in the long haul. So I want to start proposing, and I want to make sure that I'm checking with you. I can do this. I want to take my HECM from age 62 instead of my Social Security. I want to take it from 62 to age 70. I don't want to take any qualified monies during that time either. So whatever I need from HECM, I just want it in this strategy, 8 years. Can I do that?
Absolutely.
So I can customize.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I don't have to pay it back if I don't want to at age 70.
That's correct.
But I could.
You could.
If I want to keep it going, I could still keep the income going.
Absolutely.
Okay, so there's a lot of flexibility here.
There is, and if things change, you can always change it down the road as well. So
you're not in granite. I think a lot of misnomer out there is, hey, once you make your election, that's it.
That's true.
Okay, so by moving my Social Security to age 70, by moving my qualified plan out to age 70 for required minimum distributions, I'm using a HECM strategy of income to take that place of the traditional Social Security, like you said, a lot of your clients take it. They say they need the income. I have no problem with that. But when I move Social Security all the way out to age 70, from age 62 to 70, think about it. That's 132% increase. I'm sorry, but that's a lot of money. And if we live longer, you're going to need every dime of it.
Yeah.
And remember, that's your spousal benefit too. You know, just so you need to push this out into age 70. So let's talk about this. I want to be able to take, I can do any type of time, 8 years, 10 years, 15, 20. I can take a lifetime HECM income, and I can take a lump sum. Tell me about the people with lump sum. I'm kind of curious on that one because I'm always an income guy, so yeah. I never think about lump sum, and I'm thinking, man, if I hand my client lump sum tax-free, don't have to pay it back,
yeah.
they will burn through that money like there's no tomorrow. And most advisors watching would agree.
Yes, well, that's true. And what the government's done is, let's say you have you're eligible to take a lump sum amount, they will actually limit the amount you can take in year one. So it's this burn through, mm-hmm. you windfall, mm-hmm. and people go crazy. So they've put some limitations on your access to the lump sum, mm-hmm. but by the end of year two, you've got it all.
Okay, so they even understand human behavior. Yes. That's what I just started saying. So the government's wise in this one area. Okay, so anytime I can take my lump sum, they're going to kind of give it out in a restrictive way in the first 24 months just to make sure that you don't go crazy.
Correct.
And you could do that. Now, I see huge power here, not only delaying Social Security, not only for RMDs, but I liked your other part too. At age 70, I may say, you know, I just don't need this anymore. It was great. It got me. It was a bridge to get me to age 70. Income bridge.
Yep.
And I might want to pay it back because I still want some equity in my home. I'm just going to do that. They could do that.
Absolutely.
I'm so used to that income coming in now, I'm just going to let it ride and go all the way through my life.
Correct.
I don't want to pay that back.
Don't need to.
Okay. So to me, that is the power. Now, a lot of people say, John, I use this HECM for income, and every person I've talked to that brought this up, they love all this until I get to the part, it's possible that you could actually live into your 90s. I have looked at your amortization schedules for HECM, income, purchase a home. There's possibility here that you would not have equity if you really, really lived a long time.
Well, that's true, and I guess that's fine, too. And the thing about a HECM mortgage, it's a non-recourse mm-hmm. loan. So it's secured against your house. Your estate can never pay back more than the value of your mm-hmm. house when you become deceased. So that's where the FHA insurance comes in. Mm-hmm. And that's, even though people hear FHA insurance, it allows this program to actually operate the way it does, and it protects your estate from having some huge liability in the future.
My feeling for a lot of people, and it depends upon everybody's, you got to be suitable, you have to do due diligence, I have to look at the tolerance issues for other things that the client is involved in retirement. But I'm looking at the ability, if I'm living into my 90s, it's possible that my equity position, because I haven't paid any payments, I've been taking money out.
Yeah.
So there might not be equity position in my home. And sometimes, like mother, in a case I was in, the female client the other day was concerned, oh, my children won't have any equity if I lived into my 90s. So that was a concern. Well, we want to use other aspects of finance to do that. I personally, in my HECM strategy, I use a second to die. I've already made that idea. My wife will probably live well into her 90s. So I don't look for it there. I'm using my home equity for my retirement. Any equity I want to give my children, I'm using, in my case, I'm using a second to die. You could do guaranteed income, stretch IRA. There's a lot of things you can do for your children. Now, the reason I bring up this whole issue is I want everybody to know it's tax-free. It doesn't come on your Social Security. You can make a lump sum. You can take from 62 to 70 in my bridge technique. Mm-hmm. You could do your lifetime income. All this is there. Now, to do this, I noticed that you told me, Steve, make sure the client, it's really great if the client still pulling a W-2. It makes underwriting a lot easier.
Well, yeah, you still have to qualify for mm-hmm. a HECM program. So they're looking for, they do look at residual income. So there's some residual income tests that they look at. It's basically, if it's a two-person household, mm-hmm. after all your expenses, you need about $900 to $1,000 residual income mm-hmm. to qualify it. They also look at your credit. Do you have the willingness and capacity to repay the loan? Even though you're not repaying it, they're still looking at your mm-hmm. overall credit soundness. And so if there's derogatory events, mortgage lates, bankruptcies, foreclosures, you could run into a situation mm-hmm. where you don't qualify, but under that circumstance, what they're really what the underwriters are looking for: are you going to pay your property taxes? Are you going to be able to continue to pay your homeowner's insurance? And are you going to be able to maintain the house?
Well, listen, don't forget to watch our next segment on purchasing a home under HECM, part 4 of our series on the HECM retirement strategies. And keep in mind, before moving forward with any of the ideas on the show, always check with your tax consultant, legal counsel, and compliance officer. And don't forget to subscribe to my consumer show, Steve Savant's Money, The Name of the Game. Daily content that you can post on your website, social media accounts, database distribution. I'm Steve Savant. Thanks for watching.